Assalamu alaikum viewers, welcome to the program Organizational Behavior. In today's episode, which is the fourth episode, which is the fourth program, we're going to discuss the concepts perception and attribution. We have with us our expert, Mr. Fawad Bashir, who is an expert on the subject organizational behavior, and the presence of you students, Amna, Abdul Rahim, Bilal, and Alia. Thank you all for being with us. And I think Bilal will start with the question, sir.
Yes, I have a question. What is perception and why is it important?
Okay. First of all, again, when we start from the previous lecture, we learn something, we observe things from the environment. Observation is also a major source of learning. On the basis of past experiences, observations, and the experiences of others, which we share with them. Basically, there is a mindset of a person on the basis of which we analyze the reality or the paradigm around us. Perception is defined as a process by which individuals organize, first of all, and interpret, second, their sensory impressions, that is the third thing, in order to give meaning to their environment. Sensory impressions are basically five senses which plays a role of input devices like a computer. And whenever we get certain information through these five senses, like hearing, vision,
taste,
smell. Touch, smell, five senses. When we get the input from these senses through our perception, which is like the computer's processor, we'll convert it into a meaningful interpretation of the senses, basically. Yes. And so far as our attitude and behaviors are concerned, perception is the basis on the basis of which our personality, the building of the personality, the attitude and behaviors are built upon.
Okay. Abdul Rahim, you have a question?
Sir, I have a question that how can we determine whether it is internally or externally caused in the behavior of individual?
Basically, it is difficult to interpret because even that person who is exhibiting a certain behavior, he or she, himself or herself, will not be able to determine whether that thing is influenced by past experience, internally caused or externally caused. But through in-depth analysis, those can be defined. But at least we can define that what sort of like inputs or what sort of elements will affect the perception. Basically, the factors which affect the perception depends upon multiple dimensions. First of all, factors in the perceiver, those are internal factors. Factors in the target, external factors on that particular object, we are making a perception or judgment. And factors in the situation, like the attitude we have discussed, motives we will discuss later, interests, experiences, and expectations. These are the internal factors of the perceiver, which will affect the perception. If my interest is very high, definitely I'll try to perceive that thing into very depth of it. If my motive is very strong, my expectations are high, if all these things are towards the stronger or higher side, definitely perception will be a very, very important thing for me. Yes. I want to perceive it to the depth of it. Factors in the target, novelty. Novelty means the newness. If that object is new object I am encountering it for the very first time, definitely it will take time to perceive about it. I have to gather certain information, set up
information. And it is not necessary that the perception is going to be positive about it.
Need not to be. Because as we have discussed attitudes have two dimensions, positive, negative, favorable, unfavorable.
Sir, when individuals perceive job in negative terms, it will increase absentees and it will decrease job satisfaction.
Very right.
Also the turnover rate
will increase, definitely. Perception is generic thing on the basis of which certain attitudes which we have already discussed, motives and these things are based upon it. So we have to take perception into a very major consideration, one of the very major consideration.
Are we to infer that that behavior is formed because of the perceptions as well?
Excuse me?
Are we to infer that the behavior is also formed because of the perceptions?
Yeah, it is a very basic thing. Because whenever we try to understand something, we will collect information through our perception, will convert into a meaningful interpretation.
Okay.
And that interpretation for me is reality.
Oh.
For all of you, that might be the one of the very, you can say, normal thing, but for me it might be very important.
Mm-hmm.
So it all depends upon my perceptions.
So we can say that there is an attribution theory in perception, which means that the individuals, what they think about the particular actions or behaviors, means
right,
how
right.
they relate them to the internal factors or the external factors, means if they achieve the desired outcome, then
yeah.
they can say that it is due to their internal factors.
Yeah.
And if there is a failure, then they can blame the external factors for that particular failure.
Basically,
I think we have given a very good example.
As we are discussing that, because there are multiple factors, novelty, motion, if that object is moving,
mm-hmm.
perception will be different, sounds will create
an
effect and impact, size. Objectives, tiny, definitely,
the perception
will create
will be
a different perception if that is a huge background, the proximity, and the
similarity.
Okay. Then the time, if that, if I'm working in an organization, and early in the morning, I go there, I'm very energetic.
Mm.
That time is when my mind is working at its peak.
Yeah.
Yes.
But by the time is going on, and at the time of like when I'll be leaving for the home, at that time I might not be willing to do anything extra.
Exhausted
sort of. Work setting, social setting, these are the things which will affect the perception of anyone. As Alia said, basically it's a bias. And a very interesting phenomenon, I would say, attribution theory. Attribution theory has got two dimensions.
Right.
We'll discuss it later, that whenever we try to judge others, we take different parameters, and we try to judge ourselves, we take
different
parameters.
We are lenient, rather, when
towards
you're
ourselves.
Judging ourselves.
Yes,
and very harsh towards others.
Exactly.
So attribution theory, when individuals observe behavior, they attempt to determine whether it is internally or externally caused. And on the basis of which, we take three major elements, distinctiveness, whether, which shows different behaviors in different situations, distinctive behavior. The second is consensus. Response is the same as others to the same situation. That means on that particular behavior there is a consensus. And consistency, responds in the same way over the time, if that person. On the basis of these three things, we can better judge a person, like how we can attribute that, whether that thing is internally caused by that person's personality, internal things,
or
externally
it is external.
Caused. Like, we can refer to that particular slide.
Mm-hmm.
Individual behavior, basically, if that is distinctive, means he or she shows different behavior in different situations, and that is a very unique one. It means it all depends on the external factors.
Yes.
Those are causing that distinctiveness. And if that is towards the higher side, it is externally caused. If that is towards the lower side, it means that person has got a very consistent behavior and there is no higher distinctiveness. Then comes the consensus that many individuals are exhibiting the same behavior.
Exactly.
It means it is externally caused, because situation is like this. If you are coming from a route on which there is a heavy rush and you got late every day, and all other employees who are opting the same route, if they got late, it means it is externally caused.
Exactly.
Because there is
all of them
rush.
Will be equally frustrated.
Yeah, yeah. And third is consistency.
Mm-hmm.
If behavior is very consistent and you time and again you come late, it means if consistency is there, it means that is internally caused, because this is because of your internal behavior.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, I have a question here from you students, that what are the errors and biases in attributions, if anyone wants to.
Sir, actually there are two errors, and first is fundamental attribution error. Basically it is the tendency to underestimate the influence of external factors and overestimating the influence of internal factors when making judgments about others.
All right. Okay. Anyone else wants?
And the next one is self-serving bias. It means that the individuals take credit for the desired outcomes, while they externalize the responsibility for the undesired outcomes.
As in, you are trying to say that if the result goes wrong, you say that it's because of
for
others?
For example, if someone says, I'm proud of my results, then you may say, except one subject, when I was ill. Now, he has gained the credit of good result, but he has externalized the responsibility of bad result for illness.
Exactly. Right. That is what most of you students and we do.
There is also one error, which is the selective perceptions, in which an individual filter things on the basis of he or she see or hear for his own needs.
Right.
For example, as given example, when we come to university from our home, we focus on those things in which we are interested.
Right.
It's also one of the factors.
Anyone else?
Sir, there is an halo effect and contrast effect.
Right.
Halo effect is basically drawing an impression about an individual on a single characteristic,
right,
on a single trait.
Right.
It is so good that you students are teaching us today.
Okay.
And the contrast effect is that effect in which you compare or contrast the decision items and the reference items, and the things that are close to one another, you compare them and take decisions on their basis.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we can call them as shortcuts, as well, rather than biases.
Yes.
Because
sure.
So far as decision making or mental processing is concerned, usually we try to avoid it as much as possible, and you being a student know it very well. Okay, fundamental attribution error and self-serving bias means whenever we try to judge our performance, I'll say that I'm pretty good in it. But whenever there will be something bad or that is not result oriented, I will attribute it towards others or situations.
Mostly the teacher.
Okay, on the very other hand, if someone else is doing good, we'll say that because circumstances are favorable, that's why he or she is doing good.
Yes.
And if he or she is not performing good because he is not intelligent, he is not capable at all, then we'll attribute it towards his or her own self.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a very, very interesting thing, I would say. Then comes as selective perception. In perception, basically, when we try to understand the environment around us, we are very selective understanding the things as per our own interest. Whenever we like moving from one place to another, there are lot many things which we have passed through, but we'll recall a very few of them in which we were interested.
Exactly.
A few of the cars will be like recalled, a few of the trees or one of the billboards and one signal, that's it. And all other things might be or will be ignored by us. Then comes the hollow effect. Again, it is again a shortcut that if I have encountered with a person with certain physical characteristics, that he was like this, and when ever I saw the person with the same physical characteristics, I will try to attribute it that he or she might be having the same personality, but it is not so in generally. And then comes the contrast effect that we try to evaluate things comparatively on comparison basis, and this is a major phenomenon because for us reality is a relative phenomenon in contrast to certain like parameters on the basis of which we'll try to understand it. Okay.
There are certain frequently used shortcuts in judging others as well. Would you like to add something?
Sir, projection is attributing one's own characteristics to other people, like I'm not satisfied in. So this is like the same one you said before.
Let me put something into it. Like in case of our careers, whenever our parents try to guide us towards a specific career path, they'll try to attribute their like personality.
Yes.
They want to see what they have not achieved. They want to see in us that what they might to see in us, like they idealize that certain thing. But our ideals and perception might be different.
Might be.
Same is the case with managers. That they try to project their own self in their like they
employees.
They do not put their self in other shoes. Rather, they try to put themselves or other people in their shoes
in
or
their
in
shoes.
Their situation.
Sir, I would like to quote an example that if I don't like anyone, but I have values that says that I should like everyone.
Now
I will impose that they don't like me.
Yeah.
And I'll in this way I'll come over this guilt that I'll handle my this uncomfortable feeling.
Very right.
That is, I will project this feeling on
someone.
So there is also one thing, stereotyping, on which you judge someone on the basis of which society or group he or she belongs.
Right.
It may be internally or maybe externally. Externally from the society and internally within the organization.
Right. As daily life example is there, that there is sectarianism around us.
Yes, sir.
And if a person belongs to a certain sect, we try to judge like because he or she belongs to that particular sect,
he's going to be this way.
Yeah, he or she will be. And same is the case with the caste system.
Exactly.
That is, this
so
is the
true.
Caste of that person. We try to stereotype it.
Yes, sir.
Anything else?
Sir, specific applications in organizations, what
right.
are they?
Very right. Basically, when we try to interview employees, then we implement these or we use these biases or shortcuts.
Mm-hmm.
Like in stereotyping, if a person from a particular group from which I have a good experience or a
yes.
bad experience, I'll try to stereotype it.
Mm-hmm.
Hollow effect is that there is a single characteristic in that person's personality. I'll try to evaluate the whole personality on
exactly.
the basis of it, which is a bias.
Mm-hmm.
And same is the case with the performance evaluation
yes.
on the basis of like projection.
Mm-hmm.
Like I try to project that person towards the higher side who is similar to me.
Mm-hmm.
And managers will be more comfortable with that person. So these are biases
okay.
who which are not like you can say evaluating the true employee in case of an interview
yes,
and true performance in
but
case
they
of
they are
performance
but they are being applied
but
in
but they are used and the scope of this subject is to we try to control these biases
mm-hmm.
in the organization level as much as possible.
All
we
right.
cannot eliminate it
yes.
so
ah, you cannot because this
yes.
is human nature definitely
yeah, this is human nature sort of a thing.
So I have a question that
sure.
how perception is important to decision making. And what are the assumptions on the basis of which perception is linked to decision making?
Very
particularly
good
in an organization
yeah,
when you're
nice.
Working.
We'll start from a very simple problem solving mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, again, it is the scope of psychology. That whenever we'll encounter a problem or a situation which should be and must be handled, first of all, we will identify the discrepancy
mm-hmm.
between
mm.
the required, desired situation and the actual situation in which we are existing right now. And if that gap is very huge, we think that this is a big problem. And if
yeah.
that is very narrow, we might consider it later on. But first of all, problem is a discrepancy between some current state of affairs and a desired
state.
Exactly.
Decision is basically the choice made from two or more alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
If there is only one alternative and in life there are certain situations we don't have much alternatives, then there is no decision making. To understand the phenomenon of decision making, we'll refer toward the subject of psychology.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is the subject of psychology and very major subject. Whenever we encounter a situation in which there is a difference between the desired state and
mm.
actual state of affairs, we call it a situation to be handled and it is known as a problem.
Yes.
Like if I'm feeling hungry
mm-hmm.
and I want to eat something,
mm-hmm.
definitely desired state and the actual state is different.
Actual state
and definitely that discrepancy should be removed. But this is a routine problem.
Yes.
Whenever we'll encounter a complex situation
mm.
and there are a lot many alternatives which might satisfy or remove that discrepancy,
mm-hmm.
then comes the decision making process.
Exactly.
And decision making starts from multiple choices. When there is only one choice, it means need not to make any decision.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
You have no choice to
yeah,
make any
basically.
Decision.
And if there are two or more alternatives, then we try to make something
mm-hmm.
out of it. And perception again plays a very vital and important role because
exactly.
as we already discussed, perception is based upon internally, externally, both sort of factors. Internal factors are like interest, the strength of the motive,
mm.
definitely it will like define the course of the action so far as decision making is concerned. If situation needs that we must take hasty and quick decisions,
mm.
definitely you don't have much choices.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
If we have got like no constraints like time and cost, then we can linger on the situation and we can take a very appropriate decision
exactly.
because we have much resources available.
Yes.
And there are like other external factors as well. So perception plays a very vital role in first of all understanding the problem and then solving it out. It
mm-hmm.
all depends.
In decision making
yeah,
especially.
Yeah, in decision making.
Exactly.
Very right. Okay.
So what are the assumptions of the rational decision making model?
Very right. When we say what is decision making, first of all we will identify the problem,
mm-hmm.
then afterward we will identify those alternatives which can satisfy that problem, then we will try to evaluate it on the basis
okay.
of certain characteristics, criterion set by us that this thing should be judged upon like these and these things.
Your preferences.
Yeah, basically.
And this is a self-evaluation process.
Self-set criterion. In case of an individual decision making and in case of an organization, it is set by a group of individuals. Like in case of computer, I might be considering its capacity of hard disk, its processing capability, its resolution, and its battery timing, and in the end, the price. And for another, the price might be the most important element. So it all depends.
It varies from person.
It varies from person to person. Then comes basically the decision, the choice on the basis of that analysis. And then afterward, either I'll be satisfied or dissatisfied. If I'll be satisfied, I'll repeat that thing or that phenomenon
which
again.
Discussed.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But if I'll be dissatisfied, I'll not repeat it, and the decision making will start all over again. Okay, we call it a rational decision making. But in most of the cases, most of us are not rational.
I was about to ask this thing, why is it called rational when we
basically
aren't rational most of the time?
Because there are certain assumptions. First of all, that problem is very clear to us. But in most of the cases, we're not clear about problems.
Yes, exactly.
Known options. All the options are known to us. But mostly we don't know.
Exactly.
Yeah. Then clear preferences. That, yes, my clearest preference is the hard drive. But in case of an individual, we might not be clear that what should be the preference and what should be the order of the preferences.
Yes.
That which is the which has got the higher priority and which has got the lower priority. Then the constant preferences. Our preferences, our moods, our behaviors, like they are ever changing. That if at one time I'm taking one decision, at some other time, in a different mood, in a different situation, I might be taking another decision.
Another decision.
Because
exactly.
consistency usually is not there. No time or cost constraints, that I have abundance of resources and time available, which is generally
unrealistic.
Exactly. And maximum payoff, that whatever I'm doing, it will pay me off.
Maximum
is nothing. Because in those available circumstances, that is the best choice. In those circumstances, but whenever circumstances will change, the best will change as well.
Exactly. Yes. We'll think later on that it could have been better.
And we can work for the optimum situation.
Yeah. We can say that we try to optimize the current situation, current resources, current available information or whatsoever it is. Okay.
Sir, I have a question here. What factor do you think differentiate a good decision maker from poor ones?
That is a very good question.
Yeah, very right. Basically, as we have already discussed, that there are certain steps. Okay, a good decision maker must first of all clarify what is the problem. What is it all about?
Define
because
the problem.
Yeah, because identifying a problem in itself is problematic. Because we're not clear about it, what we are opting for. Then decision criterion, and so far as an organization-wide decision making is concerned, we try to rationalize it as much as possible. Like we'll try to define like what are the decision criterion.
So up to optimum level.
Optimum level. We'll try to allocate weights, very realistic weights, that which is a higher priority and which is the lower one. Allocating weights to the criteria, then we'll develop alternatives. Those alternatives which are definitely like supposed to satisfy that particular thing. Then evaluate it on the basis of those characteristics. We can allocate certain weights and we'll give score and we'll calculate the weighted score of it.
Yes.
So as you are given certain questions in the exam with higher weights and certain with lower weights, and you try to attempt that question to its maximum, because you will try to like get a higher grade in it. So that question is very important to you, and then select the best alternative. Okay, so a good decision maker is who will try to rationalize the process as much as possible, and try to restrict those biases which are already in our perceptions.
And also
we'll
have alternatives as well.
Yeah, very right.
Okay. Anyone wants to ask another question?
What is creativity and what are the components contributing to creativity?
Very right. As we have already discussed, that so far as routine problems are concerned, like if I'm hungry, I'll take food, that's it, a routine problem. But if we are hungry and we are also opting for some recreation, we'll go to a certain resort, we'll go to like a certain restaurant, we'll try to chill it out, and we'll try to take like enjoy the food as well.
Exactly.
Then the parameters are different.
Yes.
Okay. If we'll try to tackle a structured problem, that is a routine thing, we need need no creativity into it.
Mm-hmm. We are prepared for it.
Yeah, we are prepared for it. We're ready for it. We've already taken a decision. We'll repeat it time and again.
Mm-hmm.
But so far as a unique situation is there.
Mm-hmm.
First time encounter is there. Novelty or newness is high in that particular situation. Then definitely we have to handle that decision very creatively. And creative potential varies from one person to another.
But yes. It is there in every person.
Yeah, it is there in every person. It all depends that I am creative in that particular area in which I am more interested.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
In which
it all depends on the interest of the person.
Yeah. Interest and the strength of the motive.
Mm-hmm.
So there are three major components of the creativity, and there is a model known as three component model of creativity.
Okay.
And propositions that individual creativity require, first of all, expertise.
Mm.
Yes.
If I'm expert into it, then I might be more creative into it. And then comes the task motivation.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm very much motivated in doing that particular thing, then I'll try to inculcate more creativity into
exactly.
it. And third thing is creativity skills.
Exactly.
And that is inborn, that is God gifted.
That you inherit.
It varies from person to person, but every person do possess it. But again, it varies from person to person. So it is not merely the creative skill in a person which will make that person more creative.
Mm-hmm.
It is combination of these say things. Like
as in you are trying to say that if a person is interested in photography has some inborn skills for doing photography, if there is a competition, that is going to be the task motivation for it. And then if he goes for some course or something, that is going to be the skill.
Yeah, very right. A very appropriate example.
Mm-hmm. Bilal, do you want to ask a question?
Yes, I have a question. Yeah, how decisions are actually made in an organization? Because if two or more than person are sit together to find a decision, everyone is different from each other.
Exactly.
No one is focused on one simple solution.
Very right. Because you are very right that every person have got different
perceptions,
personality, different opinion, mindset, different background. Each and everything will affect it.
So I'd like to add something that
very
there
right.
are certain limitations as
very
well,
right.
which affect the decisions.
Mm.
Right.
I would like to add something that there are certain constraints that affect the decision making.
Right.
Three are the major constraints, which are the first one is the time constraint,
very
that
right.
you have limited time
very
to
right.
make decisions.
Right.
Second one is the human mind,
mm-hmm.
that
mm-hmm.
human mind is capable. Has limited capacity to process or evaluate the information. And the third one is that often we have limited and unreliable information.
Exactly.
That affects our rationality.
Our decisions.
That is known as bounded rationality.
Yes.
Exactly.
This concept is known as
bounded rationality.
Sir, there is another intuitive decision making.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly intuition means that based on past experiences.
Okay.
But my question is that when people most likely use intuitive decision making?
Okay, so far as this literary definition of intuition is concerned, I somehow disagree with it.
Mm-hmm.
Because so far as your intuition is concerned, it is not anything which is bounded in time, in space, on the basis of your past experiences. There are a lot many examples in science, like the shape of benzene.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
It
yes.
is hexagonal, I think.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And that was revealed to that person in a dream that this might be like this.
Exactly.
So you cannot give any
rational
justification
or
towards that
logic.
Thing.
Exactly.
And there are a lot many other things. And in our daily lives, we also, at times, there is a gut feeling that I should be doing this, but without any rationale behind it. So intuition, Einstein says that so far as knowledge is concerned, knowledge is limited, but intuition is unlimited.
Mm-hmm.
So far as intuition is concerned, every person has got intuitive capabilities.
Exactly.
But so far as the information is not available,
mm-hmm.
or situation is that which is very complex, and then there is a gut feeling which get ourselves out of that particular situation. So rationality is bounded. Intuition
yes.
is that thing which will get us out of those boundaries, and we can take certain appropriate decisions. And it is a known fact
yes.
in the behavioral sciences. So intuitive managers, as we've already said, that they are more capable and their decisions are more applicable to those situations in which we don't have got enough information. There are other considerations as well. In mostly managers use heuristics,
yes.
judgment, rule of thumbs.
Exactly. Yes.
Basically, as I have heard something about it, they will do this thing like this, it will happen like this, without knowing the logic behind it. And these heuristics are commonly used in our lives, in managerial lives.
It's also called as experience-based techniques.
Yeah, experience-based techniques. Yes. And then comes, there are two basically parts of heuristics as well, but based upon those judgments, past experience. Again, there is another bias or shortcut known as escalation to commitment.
Uh-huh.
The decision made in past, like those decisions, whether they are nightmares to us, but those decisions will affect our current choices.
Exactly.
Yes.
If there is a choice which was proven better in past, but might not better in current
future.
Situation.
Exactly.
But
current
due
situation.
To that bias or shortcut known as escalation to commitment, we try to use it out.
Uh-huh.
We'll try to figure it out that how many choices are there in decision making styles. There are two parameters, way of thinking and tolerance for ambiguity. Okay, way of thinking might be rational or intuitive, and the tolerance against ambiguity, whether that is low or high.
Yes,
when we're certain not sure about certain things,
yeah,
ambiguity.
Yeah. Few of us might not tolerate the situation if we're not clear about it, but few of us are like have high tolerance rate.
Yes.
So if we are rational and low tolerance for ambiguity, there is a directive sort of decision making that will direct that particular direction. But if we are intuitive and low tolerance for ambiguity, behavior oriented,
yes.
that behavioral component more important than that in decision making. If we are rational and tolerance for ambiguity is towards the hard side, then we are very analytical. We try to analyze the situation as much as possible. And if we are intuitive and ambiguity, tolerance against ambiguity is towards the hard side, then conceptual decision making is there.
Mm-hmm.
And as we
follow instincts.
And generally, we try to like tell students that you should be very strong in your concepts.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. With this, I think my intuition says that we have reached the end of the program. In today's program, we discussed perception, attribution, and decision making. And I'm sure that the knowledge that we are imparting is getting you, is giving you a better idea of whatever the subject is all about. With this, I'd like to say Allah.